The personal protective equipment, PPE, worn by actors in this video was selected based on a risk assessment of the chemicals used in the experiment and conditions simulated in the activity. In scenes where the presenter did not wear PPE while in the lab, all chemicals were removed to eliminate chemical hazards.
In this video, you'll learn general methods and strategies for minimizing risk when using chemicals and lab equipment. Minimizing risk is part of a larger process called RAMP. RAMP stands for Recognize Hazards, Assess Risks, Minimize Risks, and Prepare for Emergencies. For this video, we'll assume you've already completed the first two steps of RAMP, Recognize Hazards and Assess Risks. The first step in minimizing risk is to think about how you could be exposed to chemicals in the lab. There are four ways chemicals can enter your body. The first is inhalation, the most common route of exposure. Some chemicals are used in gas form, which makes it easy to accidentally inhale them. But many liquid chemicals also produce a vapor. Some solids even give off fumes. Anytime you smell a chemical, you are inhaling the gas, but you might not smell all gases. Some have no odor, while others may be too dilute to smell, but still cause harm. The second most common route of exposure is direct contact with the skin or eyes. You can consider these separate routes of exposure because the tissues of the eye are extremely sensitive to damage. Two less common routes of exposure are ingesting a chemical and injecting a chemical through the skin. Injection can happen if you cut yourself on broken glassware that is contaminated with a chemical. Ingestion isn't very common since tasting, drinking, or eating lab chemicals or food is strictly forbidden in the lab. Once we've identified these potential routes of exposure, minimizing risks is the next step. A common way to think about reducing risk is the hierarchy of controls. This inverted pyramid shows the most effective strategies at the top and the least effective or less reliable at the bottom. At the top of the pyramid is elimination, which is the best way to minimize risk. If there's no hazard, there's obviously no risk. If we can't completely eliminate the hazard, we may be able to reduce the scale. In other words, perform a smaller version of the experiment. That way, if something goes wrong, the effect will be less. A smaller scale means it's cheaper too. Substitution can have the same effect as elimination. For example, if a solvent is flammable, perhaps it can be replaced with another solvent that is less flammable. Options 1 and 2 at the top of the pyramid have more to do with designing experiments. Your instructors have probably considered these already. So let's focus on the lower 3 options, which are steps you can take while in the lab to minimize exposure. Remember, strategies that reduce the likelihood of exposure also reduce the risk. In the lab, engineering controls usually refers to using a fume hood. The main purpose of a hood is to remove gases and vapors. This lowers the chance of inhalation, as well as fire or explosions. It's important to note that a hood is most effective only when used correctly. Using any equipment the wrong way could lead to a false sense of security. Check to make sure the hood is on by holding a tissue at the face of the hood. Always look for a test sticker that tells you the equipment is being maintained. Also, is the equipment positioned at least 6 inches away from the sash? This is important so the hood can effectively capture gases and vapors. Are there any unnecessary containers or equipment that could block airflow? Are there stored chemicals that could catch fire? Is the sash down? Hoods aren't designed to contain a fiery disaster, but they'll help lessen their impact, particularly when the sash is fully closed. Administrative controls are a wide range of behaviors that can help minimize exposure and lower risk in the lab. Your college or university will have its own set of lab rules. All of these were developed with risk minimization in mind, and you should know and follow these rules in your labs. Prepare for each experiment by reading the safety precautions provided in the directions. Follow experimental procedures as written since they were developed with safety in mind. Finally, let's talk about personal protective equipment, PPE, and lab dress, the last line of defense in preventing exposure. Proper eye protection is required in all labs where chemicals are used and there's a possibility of chemical splash. For most situations, you'll want to wear indirectly vented splash goggles. Many institutions require these in all chemistry labs at all times. Some allow safety glasses. You need to know and follow what your institution requires. What about dress? It's really quite simple. To minimize exposure, cover as much skin as possible. It's smarter to wear long sleeves rather than short sleeves. Natural fiber materials are best since synthetic fabrics burn more easily. Many institutions will also require use of a lab coat. Just like eye protection, you need to know the local rules for clothing and lab coats. Skin exposure is always possible when handling chemicals, and gloves are the best way to prevent this. Lab gloves should be considered one-time use disposable gloves. you should select a material that is resistant to whatever chemical you're using. There are easy to find resources online that describe how various glove materials protect against chemicals. In lab class, the best glove material has usually been determined for you. Your instructor will advise you on the specific rules for using gloves at your institution. Remember that chemicals can be transferred from your gloves to any item you touch, a calculator, computer, or cell phone. Chemicals can also be transferred to your pen and enter the body if you place it in your mouth. This kind of chemical transfer is why food and drinks aren't allowed in the lab. Finally, remember to always remove your gloves before leaving lab and to wash your hands at the end of class. To minimize exposure, it's important to remove gloves correctly so chemicals don't contact your skin. To start, pinch the first glove to remove close to the wrist and start peeling it off while turning it inside out. Crumple the removed glove in the palm of the gloved hand. Now use your ungloved hand to peel off the second glove and enclose the crumpled one. Discard these used gloves as directed by your instructor. When thinking about minimizing risk, what level is acceptable? In your labs, the risks have likely been reduced to a reasonably low level by your instructor, but the risks might be medium when using particularly hazardous chemicals where no good substitute exists. In research labs, the question of when to accept higher risk is more complicated. You may face this question someday. Staying safe in the lab requires constant vigilance about hazards and the steps to minimize risk. Thinking about routes of exposure, when to use a hood, and what PPE to wear will help keep you safe. To learn more about the other steps in RAMP, be sure to check out the other 5 videos in this series. You can find them by clicking here, checking out the links in the description, or visiting acs.org/safety-videos.
Okay, take one.
A flammable, keep fire away, SES, computers, cheese.
I forgot, we're just making sure.
Okay.
Keep going.